Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Amit. Next, we have Manjula Kandula sharing her thoughts on career progression for technical writers. Manjula has served in various capacities in technical writing as writer, editor, and document manager, and is now with Srishti School of Art, Design, and Technology as faculty.
Thank you. First of all, before I start, I just want to thank Rajdeep for giving me this great opportunity. And Rajdeep and I go a long way, and he knows that. After these wonderful talks, my colleagues, I don't know what else to say, but let me just give a little, you must be wondering what I'm doing in a school of art, design, and technology after having worked in companies. Again, I think I would like to go back to what Sandhya said about serendipity, about opportunity. So there was this time when I've been moving through, meandering through companies, and I went to digital and then moved to HP. And then I was about to move to Wipro, but HP gave me an opportunity, an on-site opportunity. So I stayed back. But after some time, what happened was there was a personal setback in my life, which I don't want to go into. But then the company I was working with was not able to give me a part-time or whatever opportunity I wanted. And then I said, well, my life is more, home is important. So I left. And then I said, okay, what do I do now? I started looking at, I think, going the Sandhya way, if I may say. And said, let me write a small book. And I just started on something and wrote a book called Pani Puri and the Passive Voice, which is not published by anybody except me. So it's a self-published book where I haven't spent any money, but I haven't got any either. But the thing is that it gave me a great feeling, chapter after chapter, and it kept me very, very gainfully employed in my own way. So the creative writing took over. So that, as you know, that writing, there's a left brain, right brain, and I don't want to go into it, but it does act and it does interface once in a way. So what happened then was I didn't know what to do next. I said, well, do I go to another company or do I do something else? And my heart was not in moving to companies again. It just happened that way. I don't know the big 5-0 what happens, but something, there's a turning point in your life and you start looking at it. So I said, okay, what have I done? I did a PhD in biochemistry. I was in IASC, and I always, like a homing pigeon, keep going back to IASC for everything. So I did teach part-time at IASC also, and I enjoyed teaching. And so I said, let me look at teaching opportunities. And that's how Srishti happened. So if you look, I just want to tell you this because I feel that you may think that what you're doing is not really in line with your profession, right? But suddenly something happens, and what Srishti really looked at is not just a PhD, which is useful for UGC, right? And to place you in associate professor, whatever it is, that's a different thing. But what it really looked at is that little self-published book of mine and said, oh, you can be creative too. And that's how I got into Srishti. So don't ever think that what you do or what you learn or what you, go through the sidelines is something going to go for waste. Something comes back, and it's sometimes serendipity, right? So, okay, that's enough about me. I want to do a small exercise with you all. How many of you would like to take part in this? These are small papers which you can pass around. Thank you, Kiran. You can just pass it on and, give the rest to the others, perhaps. Anybody who wants to participate, it's open. I hope you have pens. You do? Okay, that's good. Even pencil works. And with Srishti, what I say is, bring your paints. Unfortunately, I can't say it here. Oh, the pen is in your folder. Thank you for telling me that. You can take your pens out. And if you still want to participate and don't have those, I wasn't sure how many of you were going to be there today, so I just got a few. You can even use your paper and just write. And I just want to ask you one question, and I want you to answer very sincerely, with honesty, as to what you think is the greatest quality that you have that has made you into a technical writer. Just think, just reflect. One quality. I'm not asking for too much, right? I learned not to ask too much from students. The hard way. I remember my first teaching class, I went with a bunch of slides to Srishti and had students look at me and say, which planet have you come from? Dude, I mean, or whatever, you know. So I learned that, you know, you have to keep adapting and improvising with students. So this is now, you're all students. I'm very happy to be with you. Please just write one quality that you feel is the most important in you that has made you take up writing. I hope I made myself clear. Right? This is not an examination, so there's no time limit, but it would be nice in the interest of good lunch that Rajdeep has promised us that you do this fast. You're going back on the good lunch? Yeah, just one quality. You can write five if you want. I have no problems with it. But if you're really prioritizing your qualities, just let me know. Have you all done this? Have you written it up? So would anybody like to volunteer and be the first to answer? Yes.
I don't understand anything so easily.
That's your quality. Yeah. So can you rephrase it and say that? I mean, you know, give it the positive spin. Rather than saying, I don't understand.
Yeah, because I put myself in other person's shoe and think that they may not understand so easily, so I try to simplify things as much as possible.
Superb. Okay. Anyway, let's hold the thought. Anybody else with any other? Let's be fair enough. Yes. Here you are.
I think people say that I'm like water. So, like water, so I take the shape in where I'm put. So the adaptability is very important.
Adaptability, very, 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 very useful. And what a quality, yeah. Seriously. Yeah, anybody else would like to? Yes.
I believe I have creativity, a lot of it. So, I have creativity. Yes, many people want to write books, trying to write books for many years. And I have already been there, done that already. So. For me, technical writing is the next step. So I can put any kind of thoughts I have into words, which I believe most people cannot do. They will have a lot of thoughts, but they won't find the right words to convey those thoughts in the right meaning. So I believe that is my strong point.
That's your question?
Yes, that is.
It's fantastic. Anyone else, please? Let's have more show of hands. Okay. I feel like Oprah Winfrey right now. But.
Attention to details. So I feel that if no one can find any mistakes, so I am there to spot a mistake, the immediate one. So I have got in that kind of eyes. So yeah. So that's what I feel is that, you know, if I see something, I feel that there is something lacking. You know, I can add value so that I get into that and I point that one. So, and also look things, you know, in a holistic way. Yeah.
Absolutely. Yes, it's very hard to find people who have that eye for detail, right? That's what I like to call it. Yes, Kiran.
Silent crowd here. So
we have a silent crowd here, but I'd like you to, you know, okay. Since you have the mic. Yeah, I have the mic.
Okay, my strength is learning continuously and sharing it, always.
I'm willing to help. When I started my career, I started as a technical support executive. Sometimes your language, when you speak, one is the accent barrier. I used to support the American crowd, and it used to be very difficult. My English used to be very insufficient. One is my accent, and second, I used to frustrate. I used to agonize over how can I help. Man, I tried everything, And sometimes I realize that this challenge is largely because I'm not able to say what is in my head. And after I thought over it, I lost some hair, and I eventually took over. When I came to Rajdeep, I was I was at a point where I was trying to understand how, meaning I knew to write, but I didn't know how to organize it to make people understand the how to gather those bits. And I think Rajdeep did a great job. I'm coming back to the question, sorry. I care to help. I want to be of help. And I think my writing, sometimes I a lot of times I'm passionate about trying to help. And that's a quality that helped me, drove me to technical writing.
Wow, that's great, that's great. Another good quality, I think, is your sense of humor. I don't think you've noticed it, but I found it, right? That's what teachers do. Yeah, Sandhya.
Yeah, mine was very simple. I think everyone has given very good answers. Mine is just purely language skills. I think that was my key thing which got me into it. Yeah.
Just like Sandhya said, when I started my career, I found that there are many software engineers who can write 500 lines of code correctly, but not 5 sentences in English correctly. So I found that I can do that, and this is a niche area which I can concentrate, and that was the beginning.
That started the whole thing. And now you become the oracle of technical writing, if I might say so. So let's get back, if I've given everybody a chance. Let's get back to what you said. So can you just repeat what you said?
I don't understand anything so easily. So I feel that things have to be simplified as much as possible. So that's others to understand. First, for me to understand. So if I understand something, anyone else can in the world can understand that. So that's what so that's why I write.
Okay, I appreciate what you said, it's not that I don't appreciate the others, but you know, I want to make a point here. So what did he say? He said that if I can understand, others can, or I'm trying to see, put myself in someone else's shoes, and that's what I wanted you to repeat. But what is that called? Putting yourself in somebody else's shoes. Empathy, absolutely, the big E. So that is something, I mean, I know that, you know, I've come from an area of where you look at functionality, you look at SDS documents, you talk to engineers, and then you say, yeah, I got it. I got the product. Now I'm going to write about it. Task number one, task number two, and then, you know, troubleshooting, whatever it is. So you prepare your manuals with great earnestness. But when you go to the field and really look at somebody and see what they understood from what you've written, are they really using the product in the way that you said? Are they really using it in a sequential manner? Perhaps I just want to look at my camera in the phone. I don't want even look at anything else. Why would I want to look at your manual which starts from A to Z, right? So today, users are smart and savvy. This is something which I just wanted to tell you. And it's not just the urban users. If you look at the rural users, you'll find they have other challenges. And believe me, as writers, you may not just only look at urban users. You may want to go to the rural area and ask them how, show them how to use a ladle rather than pick up water, you know, immerse your hand in water. You know, if you try to show them through an icon to use a ladle instead, you'll find that when you cross the icon and show that, you know, two ladles, they think it's something completely different. Right? So for you, it may be don't use something, but they may think of it as completely different because in their context, they look at the cross as a bunch of something else. So today, any company, I dare say it's Wipro because Wipro also has a university. I dare say that many companies like HP, looking at sustainable technology, will look at other users, not power users alone, right? So empathy is very important. So in order to do that, what would you do if you are going to design a product is probably go and do a survey, right? So most of the time, I've seen survey questionnaires that begin with, what did they begin with? If you're using a phone, they'll say, what are you using? What are the functions that you like? What do you really need? What is it that's missing in your phone? And we would like to do. But let's say you want to be an empathetic question. You want to be an empathetic surveyor. You may want to go and sit with a housewife and say, what's your busiest time, yeah? I mean, you know, what's your busiest time? She says, oh my God, in the morning I go crazy. I have to get the children ready. I have to do something. And she starts telling you a story. And in the story, you will find that there are certain problems that come up that the phone, the dear phone that we love so dearly, is a problem for her. So is there something else you might want to design for a housewife where she doesn't want to be disturbed in the morning, but she gets 100 phone calls and she wants to finish her housework? So the way you present a question is something which you may want to think of as writers. So storytelling is something very, very crucial for people. We found that in healthcare, especially when you talk about case studies, when you start something with a case study, or you look at somebody and say, I heard from your thing, you have diabetes. What is your biggest problem? Navigating Bangalore. What's your biggest problem? And they may say, you know, I have foot problem. I have my toes get numb. I can't walk. Does it mean that that doesn't translate to you as a technical writer and you write only about, you know, the apparatus that they're going to use? No. But the simplest thing like a foot pain can translate into a product, something which will be used. But the way you question the person is by asking them. So listening to their stories, speaking about case studies. So please understand that, you know, I was just looking at, you know, I'm supposed to speak. I said, what do I talk now? You know, you get used to it, right? Oh, talking all the time, being a faculty member, you're always on the, but you have to still think. So one thing I looked at was one of the Microsoft error messages, right? Came up with crashes, how to deal with crash. And it says, it happens. The first sentence is, it happens. So it puts the user at rest, right? But at another point, there can be a question that says, are you sure you want to perform this operation? You know, are you sure? Now, is that empathetic? No, God, I'm so scared. I don't want to even touch the laptop after that, right? So it happens. So many big companies are actually looking at how to present and make comfort, though it's not the comfort zone, it's a comfort feeling for the user, right? Another, and I want to just talk about, not too much about this, but it is also communicating which is important, empathy which is important, but metaphors also can be very, very useful when you write, right? What are metaphors? Anybody who would like to hazard a guess? And I'm not an English teacher here, standing and judging, please. Anything about metaphors? What do you think is a metaphor? Draw a parallel, absolutely. So you can draw a parallel with anything. You can draw a parallel of Bangalore's traffic to network. So what would people relate? What do they relate to? So it's important to look at how to build metaphors. You may want to think about it. And we have a very good course in Srishti now, which is creative writing. And many people are coming. And now professionals also are joining up for creative writing, where we teach critical thinking, metaphors, narratives, storytelling abilities, which all can be incorporated and can fulfill dreams of even writing books. So think about it seriously. So think about words. I don't want to call it soft skills or hard skills. Everything feeds in some ways. So you can look at words like empathy, communication, context. What about context? What is the context that you're going to write? Right? We look at it in a vertical way. We say power users, lay users, and you have, you know, things like usability. But context can also mean users who are women, who are gender users, who are perhaps nurses. So you have to look at context when you're writing something. So that is important. And of course, metaphors and culture. So there are certain icons that you have to be sensitive. These are things which you all know. I'm sure Rajdeep would have gone through all this. But I only am saying from my point of view that these are extremely important, your tools are important, your writing, but the word and the feeling that it gets you. Because that is not tangible, but it's there, right? So that's all I wanted to say. Any questions? I'll be happy if I can answer.
What you spoke easily.
You understood, so you don't have empathy. Okay.
So, you're talking about design elements, right? Mm. So, before your students visualize that,
okay, before they visualize that design element, so are you also telling them to write a story, sort of a storyboard or something like that, then put it onto the design part of it?
Yeah, good question. Actually, in one of my classes, I asked them to redesign the laptop. Right, because, I mean, not the laptop, I'm sorry, the backpack, not the laptop. So a backpack, because it's something that students always use. And I said, look, what do you find in a backpack? First of all, I asked them to reflect what they love about their backpacks, because people, we love our backpacks, don't we? Do we or don't we? Yes or no? Yeah. So what is it that you love? So they wrote that. And then afterwards, I asked them to go outside into Yalahanka, and go talk to people who hold backpacks and ask them what their biggest pain is. So they came back with these pain points, like, you know, I don't have enough pockets, I don't care for the money. That's an interesting thing, you know. They said, I don't mind paying for it, but I don't have the right type of pockets that can hold my phone properly. The wires all get meshed up. I don't have something where I can keep them all in a nice way. So then, after that, you know, due diligence, they started looking at how to redesign the backpack. And they did. I mean, they did redesign it, but prototype. So a survey. So for that, you know, how do you ask? You know, you can't just accost somebody on the road and say, hey, tell me about your backpack. You know, nobody's going to talk to you. So probably if it's a child, you say, oh, do you have a lunch bag in your lunchbox in your pack? Your mom packed a lunchbox for you? Oh, yeah, she did. You know, it's in this little packet. Then you start a conversation. So important thing is how to reach out. You can't just, you know, you have to look at the person's body language. So these are things which I teach. Are they ready to answer you, or are they not interested? If they're not interested, what do you do? And how do you practice empathetic listening? Very important. What is active listening versus empathetic listening? Come to my class, I'll tell you. That I hope it answers your question. Anybody else? Or I'm ready for lunch or whatever.
What is your book Pani Puri and Passive Voice about? Because that passive voice, maybe it could be of some use to the technical writers.
Actually, it was about, you know, the story revolves around a bunch of writers, and I mean, I'm part of them. So I've named myself different. I mean.